Supply for all the saints and angels for eternity. I said on Friday, God told me that heaven is so big to accommodate every person who was ever born, who will ever be. Because heaven is a vast planet of its own, bigger than the earth many, 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 many times. Heaven is not some small space where we are going to squeeze, try to. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Quickly, I want to just go through all these things and then I'm going to go into other things. Hallelujah. And then also, the first thing that you will notice, I think, before anything else is the presence of light. Remember the book of 1 John, it says, God is light, with him there is no darkness at all. When I was looking in heaven, there is not even darkness. There are trees and mountains. You walk there, or you look there, you can't even see your shadow. There is no shadow, no darkness. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And then also, one thing that the Lord also told me to talk to people about the music and the worship in heaven, so that the worshippers, they may know. Hallelujah. John chapter 4, God is a spirit and is looking for us, the true worshippers that worship him in spirit and in truth. Hallelujah. If you can go to heaven and listen to the music there, you will see that on the earth we have not begun worship. We don't understand, we don't know what is worship, what it means. Hallelujah. As I was there walking in heaven, the music is like literally comes out of the ground. You don't, sometimes you don't see the source, but this music, incredible music that you've never heard. The music that is so pure, so this harmony between the instruments and the voices of the people that are singing. Hallelujah. And the music fills the sky. And you can almost see music, because as I was speaking, I saw musical notes flying in the air, the music is singing. You can almost not only see and hear, but you can, like, you, in a sense, you see music. Because in heaven, all your senses, they are alert. You see, you hear, you smell, you taste the smell of God in that place. Hallelujah. God wants us to really worship him, to give him our best when we worship him. Hallelujah. The angels that I saw there worshiping God in heaven, they it's about God. It's not about a person. Hallelujah. It's about God. It's not about a person, that worship that I heard. You need to be there and hear that kind of worship. Hallelujah. Then you will see why the angels in heaven are always saying, holy, holy is the Lord. The whole earth is full of his glory. Holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Who was, who is, and who is to come. You know, worship is one of the major things that we're going to be doing in heaven for eternity.
Amen.
Continually, even when you are doing something in paradise, you'll be worshiping. Even if when you are doing something in the city, you'll be worshiping. Jesus will be a continuous song on your lips.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. David says in the book of Psalms, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Because his praise shall continually be in my lips. Hallelujah. I will not worship when I feel everything is okay. I will not worship when I have a husband. I will not worship when I have money. No, money is there or not, Jesus is still Lord. His praise shall continually be in my lips.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. So the worshipers, I pray that may God give you grace that you go to heaven.
Amen.
Just to go and experience music there in heaven.
Amen.
And when you come from heaven, your total concept and perception of worship, it will change it drastically.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
And then also, on a particular Sunday before I went to church, suddenly I was thinking to heaven instantly. They said, it's called the Garden of God. Hallelujah. And then in this Garden of God, you see all kinds of fruit trees. All kinds of fruit trees, and the river of life is passing through the Garden of God. And then I noticed something. They told us to pick fruits. And then I picked a fruit. And when I looked where I picked the fruit, there was a small growing to become the next fruit. You remove a fruit, and another fruit will grow when you just remove the fruit there.
Amen.
And the fruits that I saw in heaven, they come with different kinds of weird shapes. And sizes are so big. It's a common one they like to give people when they go to heaven. That is shaped like a pear. That is shaped like a pear. And there are some even apples, but they don't look like apples of here that you know. Hallelujah. And as I was eating those fruits, the Lord was making me know by then, he said, these fruits, they impart some things in your spirit that will help you to do your assignment when you're here on the earth. Yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I even drank water. The angel gave me to drink water from the river of life. You can feel strength. You can feel your spirit being rejuvenated. Hallelujah. Because this river, this water of life is simply the appearing or the manifestation of the Spirit of God. It's not just like water that we know. It's the appearing of the Spirit of God, because water is a type, is an emblem of the Holy Spirit. That is why John chapter 7 verse 37, I believe you'll be right in the scriptures. Jesus says, "He who is thirsty, let him come unto me and drink." Hallelujah. The last day of the feast, he cried out with a loud voice, "He who is thirsty, let him come unto me and drink. And out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water." And the Bible said, this he spoke of the Spirit, because the Spirit was not yet poured out, because Jesus was not yet glorified. So the river that comes from underneath the throne of God is simply the life of God, is simply the appearing of the Spirit of God. Amen. Hallelujah. That's the place about the burden of God. And then also God gave me an important assignment to come and talk to women, specifically women, on the actual. I saw children of all races and languages of all countries there in one place, playing peacefully, without stress, without sickness, without any problem. And the Lord was speaking to me. Many of the children that I was seeing, they died on the earth at the state of infancy, and some they died when they were still in the mother's womb, either by stillbirth, miscarriage, or they died because of abortion. Hallelujah. When conception happens, that is a human being there. Hallelujah. And when the children they die, angels are sent from heaven. They take their souls to heaven. And when they go to heaven, they are made to grow and they are taught the things of God. Hallelujah. They are made to grow. And the Lord told me to go and tell women on the earth, especially those who have committed abortion, that if they repent of their sins, if they become born again and they live a righteous life, a life that is pleasing to Him, when they die and they go to heaven, they will receive that baby's back.
Amen.
Hallelujah. So if your baby died like 2 years or a year ago or whatever, 3 years, if you die now or Jesus comes to them, you will raise your own child when you get to heaven. But if it takes you a longer period of time for you to be with the Lord in heaven, when you go to heaven, you will find your child as a fully grown young man, young lady, and they will come to you and say, "Mama."
Amen.
Hallelujah. Yes, God does not lose a baby. There's not even a single baby who died below the age of accountability, 6, 5, 3, or in the womb, who is lost. God takes care of the babies. And said, He said, "Leave the children to come unto me. For theirs is," there are many, many children there in heaven, because every year abortion, miscarriage, and kids will die below the age of accountability. Heaven is full of them. And then I saw something also. There are saints that are like motherly saints. Hallelujah. The feminine saints in heaven and the feminine angels of heaven that are taking care of these children. There's a children's facility in heaven that are taking care of these babies that are made to grow and are taught the things of God, that taught the worship songs and praise songs and the knowledge of the kingdom of God, and they grow and they reach a certain age and then they stop growing. There's no old man, no old woman in heaven. When you meet your great-grandfather in heaven, he will look like a healthy young man.
Amen.
Wow.
Hallelujah. If somebody dies in a wheelchair here, in heaven nobody uses a wheelchair. In heaven no sickness. Everyone is strong, full of youthfulness. Even the angels, there's no man who has wrinkles, pimples, scars. There's no such thing. Hallelujah.
Amen.
You have to go to heaven.
Amen.
I think you have to go to heaven.
Amen.
The Lord told me that any person wants to make it to heaven, there's enough grace to make that person to go.
Amen.
So if the person goes to hell, it's not that God didn't want them to go to heaven. It's because the person deliberately, God was standing on the waist trying to stop the person. God was the person was wrestling against God. "I want to go to hell. I want to go to hell." Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And then also, there was one time I saw something. I was moving the spiritual realm at a great speed. Hallelujah. And then I appeared in heaven and I flew over paradise and I came and stood by the city. Hallelujah. And so the New Jerusalem is the capital into the city. The book of life. Hallelujah. Remember what it says in Revelation chapter 3, chapter 2. He who overcomes, I will not blot or erase his name from the book of life, but I will confess it before my Father and before his angels. As you're about to step into the city, there is a book called the book of life, a big golden book. And I've been asking the Lord, Lord, yes, I know that you're using me, but I want to go and see if my name is written in the book of life. And when the angel took me to heaven, God gave me special grace. And I saw the book there. And then when I was looking at the book, the pages began to like flip themselves as if there's a soft breeze that is on the, and it can open exactly to the section where your name is. And when I was looking for my name there, I did not find any English, no Swahili, no Setswana, nothing. Hallelujah. As I was looking for my name there, I saw that my name was there, but it was not Moses, prophet, which is the most. It was not that. It was translated into a heavenly language. But even right now, I cannot tell you how it was because I've never seen anything like that. Hallelujah. Remember, he said when he was given the promises to the overcomers, he says, he who overcomes, I will give him a new name.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Your name will be written in the book of life, but it will be written in not Setswana, Swahili, Shona, nothing, but it will be written in a heavenly language. Hallelujah. And when I saw my name, I was shouting, I was jubilating, I was excited. Hallelujah. Because I know that is the only book that will matter when the white throne judgment comes. Hallelujah. He says, if any man's name was not found written in the book of life, immediately there is no any other thing. But the person was cast into the lake that best would find him. So that is the book that decides your eternity if you are going to heaven or not. Hallelujah. And also sometime later when I came also about the book of life, the Lord showed me something that I was seeing new names being written and some old names being removed. Hallelujah. And then I was asking why I see names being written and now I see some other names being blotted out. And this is what the Lord was speaking to me. The old names that were erased are for people who were serving God or Christians and believers. Then they decide one day they are going back to the world. They are going back to that old ways, that sinful ways. And when they do, they are removing their names from the book of life. That is what God told Moses. Any man who sins against me, that is the one that I will blot out from the book that I am writing. Hallelujah. Your name is not removed from the book of life when you lie in that moment. No. When you commit a sin, God is waiting for repentance to take place. And as Christians, we must learn to repent on moment's notice. Immediately when you notice that you have sinned, don't wait until you get home. If you die now or a rapture happens, same one will happen. When you sin, you are supposed to repent of your sins immediately and forsake your sins. Because God has asked us to repent, not to apologize. Because repentance means to turn 180 degrees turn from the way you were working. So if you repent of alcohol, you can no longer go back there because you turn your back against alcohol and you walk in the opposite direction.
Amen.
So names were removed of backslidden Christians. Not a Christian who just sinned now. Hallelujah. And then if you sin, you don't repent. You sin, you don't repent. And then now you are habitually practicing. Your name becomes faint in the book of life. You sin, you don't repent, it becomes fainter. You continue until the name is totally wiped out of the book of life. And then the names that I saw, people who repent in the redeemed to the first love. And people who are never seen as you're preaching the gospel, the person truly believes in his heart, like Romans chapter 10, you should believe in thy heart and confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus. If they, in this way they truly believe and they make that confession with their mouth, the names are written in the book of life. When the rapture happens, when you die, that is the book that will matter. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Is your name in the book of life?
Yes.
Yes.
Is your name in the book of life?
Yes.
You don't need a vision to go to heaven to know your name is in the book of life. If you are living a life that is pleasing before God, you are living a repentant life, if you are living a holy life, a righteous life, if you are, you know, you are just surrendering yourself totally to the Lord, you can be assured that your name is written in the book of life. Paul sometimes was speaking his epistles and he was saying, greet so and so, you know, these brothers that greet you, whose names are written in the book of life. You can be assured that your name is in the book of life if you are living a life that is holy before God. And many of those who died in the Old Testament, they were raised and they went into the holy seat and appeared to me. And then when Jesus went to heaven, a cloud received him. And these guys also, they went with him in heaven. And nowadays, when you die as a holy Christian, you don't go down to Hades or Abraham's bosom, but you are ushered into the presence of God in heaven. Hallelujah. So, when I was looking in heaven, you see people that the Bible is talking about, even some that the Bible has never talked about, they were living in those days. Hallelujah. I saw Father Abraham in heaven. Hallelujah. I saw Prophet Elijah in heaven. And remember, I said Elijah has what, a body, but that body is a transform. Hallelujah. And then I saw Moses there in heaven. And I saw Enoch there in heaven. I saw Apostle Paul in heaven. And I will talk with Apostle Paul. And Apostle Paul is not a big man, tall man, is like a short man, small man. Hallelujah. I saw the apostles of the Lamb, John and James. I saw Mary, the mother of Jesus. One time the Lord was giving me an accurate prophecy for somebody. I was instantly taken to heaven. And then I was with Mary, and I was speaking with Mary some things. And God was just giving me a prophetic message for somebody. Hallelujah. And then I've seen a lot of people, awesome people, great saints, the patriarchs there in heaven, Daniel and Samuel, the prophets. And sometimes there's some meetings for these patriarchs and these great men and women of God. Hallelujah. And as you're working in heaven, suddenly when God gives you grace, you can be there and the Holy Spirit will make you know. And you don't need to have seen these people on the earth. When you are there in heaven, there's what is called revelation knowledge. You look at somebody immediately, the Holy Spirit will impress in your spirit who that person is. And you will know. That's what Paul says, we'll know one another. We will know one another when we get there. Even if you are living the other side of the continent, the other side of the world, when you go to heaven, I will know you.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I will know you. I was telling somebody in Facebook, I said, in the world, they say, blood is thicker than water. Talking about how family is important and how family is closer. But I say in the kingdom, spirit is thicker than blood.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. If you are a born again child of God, you are my heavenly sibling, my heavenly brother and sister. And we live for eternity in heaven. Hallelujah. And there is no racism in heaven. Hallelujah. There is no language barrier in heaven. We will understand one another. Hallelujah. Are we getting blessed by this message?
Yes.
And then also one thing that the Holy Spirit is reminding me quickly, in heaven there's degrees. There's degrees. Hallelujah. Daniel chapter 12 talks about two kinds of people. There are some people who are wise, they are shining like the brightness of the firmament on the skies. And there's those who are willing souls who are tiny men to righteousness and are shining like stars forever and ever. And Paul in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 15, he talks about the glory of the sun, the glory of the moon, and the glory of the stars, and how they vary, talking about the spiritual bodies. Hallelujah. So in the heaven, the people they shine with different degrees of glory depending on that walk with God here on the earth. And also how you're going to live in heaven. You're going to live in the street and a location of depending on how you walk with God here now. Hallelujah. So it's not just enough to make it to heaven. Make sure that you live in a good location. Make sure that when you go to heaven, you shine with a bigger glory. People like Enoch, when I saw them, you can almost notice, well, is this an angel or is this a human? Because of how the person is shining, how the man walking with God. The Bible said the book of Genesis, Enoch walked with God habitually after the birth of Methuselah. Until one day he was walking in the spiritual realm, until one day he went too much and he couldn't go back. You can walk with God. Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. Amen. The Bible says Abraham was a friend of God. The Bible said David was a man after my own heart. The Bible said God will speak to Moses like a man speaking with his friend face to face. I said you can walk with God. Hallelujah. Amen. You can walk with God.
Amen.
And then also, people are busy. I saw not only mentions, but places that looks like a large warehouses and incredible buildings, rooms that stores things. Hallelujah. Rooms that stores things, and angels are busy and saying they are given assignment, but as that there is no fatigue, there is no uneasiness, there is only rest and joy and love and eternity. There is no night there. Hallelujah. There is no night, there is no sleeping there in heaven. But maybe I'll explain something as we go to go to the conference deeper about it. And the city of God is so big, is so vast. When you read the book of Revelation chapter 21 and 22, it talks about how the length and the breadth and the height is equal. 1,500 miles, that is like 2,200 kilometers. Imagine how big the world is. Imagine how big the gates are. Imagine something is bigger than a country, but it's only a city. Just a city, not just heaven. A city. And the wall is made of jasper. And the best way for you to make you understand jasper is like a diamond. It just sparkles. It's almost like a hallelujah. And then the pearly gates is not something that you put a hand and you open a door. No. Hallelujah. The pearly gates, when I saw them, a pearl is a milky white substance. The pearl that I saw there, white like I've never seen white, and then it's not open and it's not shut. You just come walking and walking and you drown into that substance and then you emerge. So it's not closed, it's not open. But only if your name is written in the book of life will you enter. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
The pearly gates, the Bible says, the book of Revelation, blessed are those who keep his commandments, that they may have the right to enter into the gates of the city and partake of the fruit of the tree of life. Hallelujah. And then quickly also, I'm just going quickly on to this thing, so I'm giving a guideline. I'm going to go deeper into this message as we're going to be going in the conference. And then the angels that I've seen in heaven, an angel is not an angel because he's wearing something white. An angel is not an angel, that's because there's a light that is coming out of somebody. Hallelujah. When God was making the angels, he made them as pure spirit beings that can take any form, that can appear in any way that God wants them to appear. I saw angels in heaven that are wearing white robes, and I saw angels that were so bigger than a skyscraper. Massive angels. I saw some of the warring angels that are used in us intense spiritual warfare. Hallelujah. I saw Angel Gabriel. I think I saw him twice or something. Because I saw Angel Gabriel and I saw Michael. And when I was seeing Michael, I've never seen him smiling. I'm telling you the truth before God. Hallelujah. When Michael appeared in my room, Michael was not smiling. As angels were busy praising God, Michael, he has a sword, a supernatural sword, not made with the hands of man, but the hands of Jehovah himself. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Different things. There's what is called healing angels. Angels that there's a room in heaven with body parts. That when you are praying for somebody, the person doesn't have a, maybe the person had a lung, and then they operate the lung, they remove it out, or is somehow it's not working properly. When we pray for that person with faith and the gifts of healings, angels are sent from heaven with new body parts. And as you are praying for the person, the angels are doing spiritual operation. And then the person goes to the scanner, goes to the doctors, and then they find out that the lung that they've removed, or the lung that was destroyed, or that was missing, suddenly there's a new one there.
Amen.
There's a room in heaven that has a heart and lungs and kidneys and eyes and ears and every part of man's anatomy that you can need. There's a room in heaven full of new parts for you.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. There are angels, healing angels that are working. And I've seen angels working in the food departments there in heaven. They collect food and do things. There's bread, they crush, they mix food and bread, and they make something that you have never experienced or ate. Hallelujah. There are angels that are working in the food department. And then I've seen angels that are, God is a big recording department. There are angels that are busy writing things. As people are given the love of Christ, that names, angels that record names, and then they write in the book of life. And then the messenger angels, and mostly regular class of angels are sent as messengers to people to get deliver the message. And Gabriel is God's chief messenger angel.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
And then I'll see also worshiping angels. And then there was a time I saw thousands and thousands of instruments, things that look like pianos and trumpets and flutes and this, all kinds of instruments there. And there are angels that work on that praising, they lead the praise and the worship of God. And the Lord made me know something, that what you do on the earth, if God has called you to be worship, when you die and you take it to heaven, you get the praise and worship in heaven. If you're a person who, you know, your assignment was about agriculture and farms, when you die, you take it to heaven. Paradise, I saw fields in heaven. I saw golden corn in heaven. I saw all kinds of food. So whatever you are doing now that God has given as an assignment or part of your calling, you continue to do in heaven.
Yes, sir, yes, sir.
Hallelujah. And then they tell you the glory of God, and the angels of God, they look like a handsome young man. And someday, this is what is called a feminine angels. They look like women, just like that, not women. The body, the structure, they look like women. And some of the people that are in the church there, in our church, you know, by the gift of the descent of spirit, when God shows you, some of them, they have feminine angels as the guardian angels. Hallelujah. This is just awesome things. Hallelujah. That I'm sharing with you. Hallelujah. It doesn't want your religious mindset. Hallelujah. Heaven, it will exceed your expectation and what you thought you knew about heaven. Hallelujah. And then also, there are not only angels and saints in heaven. I've seen animals in heaven. Hallelujah. I walked and I saw dogs. I saw horses, and some of the horses that I saw, they have wings, and angels are riding upon them. And remember the book of Revelation chapter 19, verse 11, when Jesus is coming on the second coming, when the heavens are open, there's a man coming riding a white horse, and behind him, the troops, the host of heaven, come riding behind him with fine linen and white horses. So on the second coming, will come riding upon white horses. Hallelujah. I saw horses there in heaven, majestic, strong, powerful horses that have wings and they fly. And I was surprised when I was there in heaven that the animals in heaven, they speak and they talk. Remember Genesis chapter 3, when Eve was in the garden, what happened? A serpent, which was an animal, spoke to Eve. So the animals in the garden, they had the ability to speak with the humans, and he was not shocked. So what is happening? I know that animals. Hallelujah.
Amen.
We teach people about the hell, whatever they can, because Jesus himself, he taught on the subject of the hell because he does not want people to go there, yet many people are going to hell. Look at what he said. If your eye is causing you to sin, he's just showing you, you know what, you should not let anything to keep you from going to heaven. He's not talking about the physical eye to go and remove your eyes. He's saying, hallelujah. He's saying, you know, no matter how close the thing is to you, if it's a sin, it's a cause of sin and stopping, remove it out. So it can be some type of relationship, some people that you must delete them from your life and delete that numbers from your phone.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. If something is a cause of stumbling and sin in your life, no matter how it might be close to your heart, you must cut it off because it's not going to help for. Hallelujah.
Amen.
On Friday, I mentioned about how Father told me that we'll go to hell. And then I saw Michael standing there at the door and the entrance and the process of evil that was coming out. How the door was open and I looked at the floor and the walls of hell, they were so dirty. When I was in heaven, there's no death, there's not even dust in heaven. But in hell, the walls are so dirty, lit up everywhere, what kind of garbage. And you walk there in the smell of hell. And the demons that I saw that were torturing people, demons of all shapes, sizes, and types, half human, half animal features. No mercy. None of those demons, they have mercy. Somebody, a woman crying, mercy, mercy, please, please, please. And the demon, they enjoy committing people. The demon come from behind with a sharp sword. He hit the woman, the ear went another direction. This eye went, and this person will be regrouped again. And some other, somebody's with the flesh, the fire is burning the person from the head and it's going down. By the time it reaches the throat, the person is turned totally into skeleton. And the new flesh will come and the fire will start from here. It goes inside your bones and reaches the heel. And then when you're tormented in hell, you're not only tormented by fire. You are experiencing all this kind of torment. And the Lord made me know that. The fire in hell is not like the fire that you know here. Some of you, if you are cooking using wood and then accidentally you step on a coal, you will scream and hallelujah. But in hell, that fire, it's like the fire that you know and magnify 1,000 times. It's the one you, when you just step in hell before they throw you into the fire, the heat there, the heat is unbearable. You feel like your flesh can just melt and drip off from you because of the intensity of the heat. That's why Jesus said the fire cannot be quenched. There's not even water in hell. There's not even humidity in hell. Hallelujah. On Friday, I talked about how so thousands of people, many of them who used to be in the church, in a Christian church, they heard a message that you must repent, turn away from your sins, turn away from idolatry, turn away from stealing, turn away from this. People, they didn't want to repent. They said, no, I still have plenty of time. Tomorrow I will repent. No, let me just do it for the last time. And tomorrow never came. And they died immediately, they were cast into hell. This is what the Lord showed me when I was taken to hell. There are tunnels that brings people into hell. Hell is like a human being lying down. It has a left leg, a right leg. It has the heart, the center. It has the jaws. And it has the hand. Hallelujah. Now, all sin leads to hell. But in hell, before that, all sins lead to hell, and people are tormented in the worst kind of ways. But certain sins, they bring you to a greater degree of punishment in hell than others. Some people in hell, they experience worse tormented than others. Yet all of them are tormented in the most horrible ways. When I was with Jesus in hell, I saw something like a stream of water. Not what a stream of liquid fire passing there in hell. And then I was made to understand the lake of fire is located now next to hell. Theoretically, it visits the hell with this liquid fire. Amen. And then I saw something. When somebody is a drunkard, they used to drink and drink and drink. Because I remember, we're to read some scriptures. I'm just trying to do this. The person will drink and drink. If the person is taken to the department of drunkards in hell. The demons, they will make sure that you will drink in hell. Except that this time now you don't want to drink. Now you will drink acid and this liquefied rice. And this thing, when it enters into you, your body explodes to little pieces. And this piece, they have to be regrouped again to be tormented. The smokers in hell, when I saw them, you smoke in hell. It's like according to the book of Galatians, when Paul was saying that whatever I meant souls, you shall reap. What you sow on the earth here, you will reap it on the earth in hell. You are a person who's going to hell, but I thank God I'm not going there. Hallelujah. The demons in hell, they give you what is like a life burning coal of fire. You put it in your mouth and you smoke it, and you don't want to, you know, it is stuck to you, you can't do anything about it. You smoke in hell, but you, now you're not smoking cigarette, you're smoking what they smoke here or there. You smoke fire there in hell. If you're a person, God gives you this mind, this head to think good things, and you use it to think immoral things, use it to think hate and all those kind of things. In hell, the demon, they come with a sword. You will see your head going in that direction. They slice you with a sharp sword, and they this head. You are, and the Lord told me that in hell, people are tormented according to the kind of sin that brought them there. And you are put in the department of the people that committed the same sin as you. If somebody is a murderer and you murder somebody, and both of you will die, you go to hell. Forever you will change your murderer and you are trying to run away from your murderer. In the hell, there will still somebody trying to murder you. There will still somebody trying to rape you. Whatever people will do on the earth, they will still be trying to continue to do it there in hell. And most of the people that I saw, they were assigned a personal demon that was tormenting them. I saw some people on. Let's read something. Let's read something quickly. First Corinthians chapter 6, verse 9. First Corinthians chapter 6, verse 9. Do you not know that the unrighteous and the wrongdoers will not inherit or have any share in the kingdom of heaven? Do not be deceived, misled, neither the impure, the immoral, nor the idolaters, nor the adulterers, nor those who participate in homosexuality, nor cheats, swindlers, and thieves, nor greedy graspers, nor the drunkards, nor the foul-mouthed revilers and slanderers, or robbers, will it inherit or have any share in the kingdom of God? Quickly go to Revelation chapter 1, Revelation chapter 21. Verse 8. He says, but as for the cowards, the contemptible and criminally lacking courage and cowardly submissive. As for the unbelieving and the faithless, as for the depraved and defiled with abominations, as for the murderers, as for the adulterers, as for the practitioners of magic arts and the idolaters, those who give supreme devotion to anyone or anything other than God, and all liars, those who knowingly convey untruth by way or deed, all of this shall have that part in the lake that brings to fire and brimstone. Hallelujah. Paul and John are making it very clear to us the kind of people that will not go to heaven. Some people, you know, when you're talking about hell, you are teaching people about this, they say, no, you it's not for you to judge. Hallelujah. Listen. Jesus was speaking, John chapter 3, he said, God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. For this reason, God sent his Son not to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved by him. But the next verse says, he who does not believe is already judged and condemned, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. So we are not judging people. It's the word of God that is already judged, that those who do this things, they will not inherit the kingdom of God. And you are not even supposed to hope that God might break his way. Amen. If God will break his way, that makes him a liar. If God said the adulterers, the adulterers are going to hell, it means so. There will be no special favors, no special treatment. There will be nothing like I was going to church. There will be nothing like, no, I was a favorite of the pastor. There will be nothing like that. God does not break his way. And according to the book of Exodus, there's no partiality with him. There's no respecter of persons. When God says something, that's how it is. If you don't want it, hallelujah. So Paul is mentioning, listen, a drunkard. Do you know what is happening? Some of us will say, no, now I don't drink. I'll never go to the bar. But this is what happens. Your sister, your brother, your friend, somebody, your uncle, they say, can you give me 50, what currency do we use here?
Shilling.
Give me 100 shilling. I want to go and grab something there at the bar and make myself happy.